It is with great pleasure I present to your pastor.
Morning in the name of Jesus Christ, the name which is above every other name, and at the name of Jesus every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Isn't that awesome? The God that we serve, there's no power and hurt that's as powerful as the God that we serve. We really would take comfort in that. Hallelujah. Knowing that the person that in charge of our lives has the greatest power that exists. No power is greater than his power. When I think of the goodness of Jesus and all that he has done for me, my soul cries out, hallelujah. Thank God. I know. Thank God, I know. Jesus, the King of all kings. The King of all kings. The conquering lion of the tribe of Judah. A God that had never lost a battle. We can take comfort. We don't need to be weary in our well-doing. We just need to trust him. Trust him. God is awesome. It's an awesome thing to trust God. And I want to greet you here and thank God for the privilege for being here. I love God. I love the people of God when we come together. And we're here to cast havoc. Create havoc in the devil's kingdom. We're here to drive fear in the devil. Amen. When we walk on this road and wherever we go, we should walk in that authority, knowing that greater is he that is in us and he that's in the world. We walk in authority, not in fear. We walk in authority, knowing that we have the power above all powers lives inside of us. Isn't that awesome? Hallelujah. When you know and have that assurance, we don't have fear. We just have trust in the God that we are serving, Jesus Christ. Amen. God's grace be good. Let us stand and declare the word of the Lord. This is the word of God.
We
live by the word.
We
die by the word. This is the word of God.
We
live by the word.
We
die by the word.
This is the word of God.
I live by the word.
And
die by the word. And may be seated in the house of the Lord. Praise God. Amen. We've been talking over the last 6 weeks. And we're looking at the works of the flesh found in Galatians chapter 5. From verse 19 to 21. And we're looking at it so that we can have the full knowledge of what it is to walk in the flesh and in the spirit. Because the Bible gives us 17 works of the flesh. And if we live and if we allow these things in our lives, the Bible says we cannot enter the kingdom of God. I found it to be very, very serious. And for that reason, I've been trying to help us to understand what it is now, because when we read it, many of us, we read the Bible and we think, well, some of the things in the Bible is not for us, and like hatred and murder, all these things. We look at it and we say, well, I'm not doing this because we're not literally doing it. So we're trying to help you to understand how it is present. How is it present in our lives today? Because we need to understand what it is, because the Bible says that if we do these 17 works of the flesh, we shall not enter into the kingdom of God. So I believe it's serious. So I don't want to minor in the minors. I want to major in the things that's important. I want to talk about the things that's important, because if it's going to stop us from going into the kingdom of God, it's important, church. What are we working for? Where are we going? Where do we want to go? We all said we're ready and we're getting ready to go to heaven. But the Bible says we shall not enter the kingdom of God if we have these things in our lives. So we got to be always search in our hearts. Always looking at scriptures. Always evaluating our lives with scripture. Always has to do that. We got to match our lives with scripture, everything that we're doing. Because one thing about Jesus Christ, he has given us grace today. But there's a day coming when grace is going to run out. When he'll be coming back as a throne and judge. And he says, "What if one of his word pass?" Just think about it. If one of his word pass, heaven and earth shall pass. So therefore, we gotta make sure the words and the word of God that's in the word of God is aligned with our lives. Because either we're going to heaven, are we going to be going to hell? Are we going to be outside the gate? There are the three places that every one of us will end up. Either in hell, and the believers will be in hell, or the Christians will be outside the gate. So if you live your life and not applying the word of God and make sure your life is where it needs to be, he's going to say, depart from me, I know you not, you workers of iniquity. And you're going to say, well, I don't go to the open man, but when you speak negative things against your brother and your sister, you're doing God injustice. Yes, so we got to know what it is that will prevent us from entering into the kingdom of God. I mentioned that we are in the first manifestation of the kingdom. Mm-hmm. And in this kingdom, you can come in as you like.
That's right. Glory.
You don't need nothing to come in. You can come in as you like. But you cannot enter into the next millennium kingdom as you like. So this is why this is the schoolroom. This is why you're supposed to get educated in the things of God. This is the schoolroom that will help you to transform your lives. That's why Paul said your mind must be renewed to the word of God. So it's okay to come in the house of God and be happy. But you need the word of God in you to transform your life. So at the end of your life's journey, you don't have to wonder where you're going.
Amen.
You know that in America, they did a survey among churches, and I figured there was 90 or 80% of the people was not sure if they're saved. How can a person call himself a Christian and they don't know if they're saved? You should know, because once you're in the house of God, it's our responsibility as shepherd of the flock is to teach the people the word of God so that they put themselves in line and get their mind in the right place so they can function the way the heart will function, so at the end of your life journey, you don't have to question and wonder. I wonder if she made it in. I wonder if he made it in. You must be able to stand out your past and say, I believe through the life that they live. I can stand and preach and teach and exhort and have a celebration. Because we should not be crying when the person is dead. You know that?
That's right.
It should be a celebration.
That's right.
And he's gone home. He's going to get a glorified body.
That's right.
And you're going to feel sorry for yourself. Oh, I'm here still up to the toil and working and I'm going through the pain and the suffering.
That's right.
But if you're not sure, then we have a problem. Because then her labor will be in vain. We're looking into number 7 today, hatred. And what is the meaning of hatred? Hatred, a strong dislike, disregard, or even indifference towards someone or something. As such, hate may be seated in a person's emotions or will. Various degrees and types of hatred are described in the Bible. This makes it difficult to define hatred in a simple, absolute terms. So, in order for us to look at it scripturally, there are many different types of hatred in the Word of God. So, hate, it's in your will to hate. It's an emotional feeling. So, that's why I like the Spirit of God. Because the Spirit of God is not emotional. It is compassionate, but it's not emotional. Because emotion is a thing like this. It's like a roller coaster. It goes up and down. It's all over the place. Today, you're my friend. Tomorrow, I don't like you.
That's right.
You see, emotions is something that will destroy you. But if you have the Spirit of God, you will have compassion. So you will tell the person the truth, whether they like it or not. Because you're going to make sure you're doing the right thing, because then you're going to show them the way you love them. You're going to make sure you're telling them the right thing. But many times you say we love somebody and you know that they're doing the wrong and you're still telling them I love you, and you're watching them do the wrong thing, but you love them. And you're participating in the wrong thing, and you love them. We cannot do that. We hate them, actually, when we're doing that. So the people of God are to hate what God himself hates with absolute hatred. So there are some things that God hates absolutely.
That's right.
And we, as a body of Christ, we must hate it too. We cannot like the things that Christ hates. We gotta hate it too. With perfect hatred. We will not be named among these things. The Bible said these things will not, should not come into our lives. Because you will not enter the kingdom of God. So what is it that God hates? The primary thing that God hates is sin. Sin bring a division between you and God. You see what I'm saying, church? If you want separation between you and God, allow sin in your lives. Today, in many churches, they don't want to talk about sin. Because they don't want to get people upset. But that's what Jesus came here for. Is to cleanse us from our sins and all unrighteousness. So the church of God must preach about sin. There's no two way about it, because that's what we are. We're sinners saved by grace, and we need to understand what is sin in the sight of God, and we should refrain from doing it. If you go to in the public school or whatever school you have, and you go in there, they're teaching you, and then they're not teaching you the right thing, what happened? You go out there and do the wrong thing. If you're going to school and they're teaching you to do math and you're not teaching them properly, what's going to happen? They will end up going to school all their life and they will still don't know how to do math. Why? Because we're not applying the curriculum. In the Church of God, we need to apply the curriculum, the Bible, the Word of God, and dilute it. It's not the way you feel. It's what the Word of God says. Feeling, emotion will destroy the body of Christ. It will destroy you. We cannot live by feeling. We must live by the undiluted Word of God. If the Word of God does not say it, you don't do it. That's why the Bible says, whom he loveth, he chasteneth. And this is how we get our chastening, through the Word of God. When the coming out of God and the Word of God is preached, you're going to take what is yours and leave what is not yours. But the Word of God must be preached in the way that the people could understand it in the simplest form. We can preach it so that the people should understand it.
Glory to God.
And we need to know what Christ ate. And he ate sin. This is what it says in Deuteronomy chapter 12, verse 21. Deuteronomy 12 and verse 31. Praise God. Thou shalt not do so unto the Lord thy God, for every abomination to the Lord which he ate have they done unto their gods. For even their sons and their daughters they have burned in the fire to their gods. Hallelujah. Isaiah chapter 61 and verse 8. For I the Lord love judgment, I hate robbery. For a burnt offering, I will direct their work in truth, and I will make an everlasting covenant with them. Hebrews chapter 9 and 1 and verse 9. Thou art love righteousness and hate iniquity, therefore God, even thy God, hath anointed thee with the oil of gladness above thy fellows. But then I dig a little deeper, and I realize that Jesus Christ ate religious people. Jesus Christ hates religious people. And we should not get into that religious state. We need to be who we are called to be, kingdom citizens in the kingdom of God.
Hallelujah.
This is what it says in Isaiah 1 verse 14. Your new moons, your appointed feasts, my soul aches; they are a trouble unto me. I am weary of them. Religion always wants to give us things to do that has nothing to do with the Word of God. Christ said he hates it. We should not be doing the things that God hates. Whatever God hates, we should not do it, Church of God. If we're doing it, then we will not enter the kingdom of God. When we're condoning sin, the things that God hates, as a church, as a body, remember, you are the church.
Hallelujah.
When you're condoning sin, you're going against God.
Yes,
and he said you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven.
Yes,
Amos chapter 5, verse 21. I despise your feast days. I will not smile in your solemn assembly. So a lot of us coming together in this religious gathering, and none of it is bringing glory to God.
Amen.
It is man's religion.
Yes,
and when we're in man's religion, Christ said he hates it. He don't want that. He wants us to come into his presence. He wants us to come glorifying him, Jesus Christ. He died for us. He died for our sins. And he ate sin. That's why he died. To redeem us from sin. Hypocrisy. He hates it. This is what he says. Zechariah 8 verse 17. And let none of you imagine evil in your heart against his neighbor. And love no false oath. For all these are things that I hate, say the Lord. lie lips is abomination unto the Lord. We have some Christians, we are so lied that we can't even talk straight. We have some Christians, every word that comes out of our mouth is a lie. If you say something to me now and I ask you the same question later, it's a different answer. He hates liars. But in the body of Christ, we have so many liars. Well, none of you, none of that could enter the kingdom of God. We got to make sure we get this thing straightened out in our life so that we can trust your words. Your life becomes such a liar that we can't even trust our own words. We're going to write a contract for everything. And you're going to sign the dotted line for everything. In the olden time, a person's word is their word.
Yes.
They said they're going to do it, they're going to do it. But today, you better sign the dotted line. Not even brothers and sisters in the church cannot have an agreement. Because they have to sign something because they're going to go against it. The Bible says he hates liars, he hates these things. This is what it says in Proverbs chapter 6, verse 16. And let none of you, six things do the Lord hate. Yea, the seven is an abomination unto him. God hates a proud look. He hates a proud look. Hallelujah. He hates a lying tongue, a hands that shed innocent blood, an heart that divided wicked imagination. You have some Christians, their imagination are so devious and so wicked. And God said, I hate it.
Yes.
And that will not get you into the kingdom of God. You can sit in this kingdom and think that you're okay. Because you go to church every Sunday.
Yes.
And you wear the tag, I'm a Christian. But is your heart in the right place? Is your hatred in your heart? Because if it's in your heart, you got to remove it.
Yes.
And it can only be removed through the power of the Holy Ghost.
Hallelujah.
No man can move it.
Amen.
Not even yourself can move it. You're going to allow God to come into your life and give you the power.
Yes. Glory to God.
To get rid of it, to get over it, church of God.
Amen.
A feet that swift in running to mischief.
Right.
Isn't that something? A feet that is swift to run to mischief. God said he hates it. But we do it anyway. Because you think you're not being judged now. But I'm telling you, the day coming,
hallelujah,
when he's coming back as a crowning judge.
Amen.
You can sit in the church building as you like, but you will not be able to go into his kingdom as you like. The kingdom is for prepared people. The kingdom of God is for prepared people.
Amen.
The churches today are sowing this God against each other.
That's right.
What type of church is that? When the Bible says he hates it.
That's right.
They don't read the scripture. But we're sowing this God against each other as brethren.
Yes, sir.
He said he hates it. How can we do the thing that God said he hates? And expect to enter the kingdom of God. You think our God is asleep? You think he's not, his eyes are not watching us? His eyes are true and from the heart.
Amen.
Looking at every one of us, we sing the song, his eyes are on this sparrow. And I know he watches me. Really? Do you know that he's watching you? And the thing that you're doing, the thing that you're practicing behind closed door, the thing that you're doing on the cell phone, the discord that you're sowing amongst your brother and your sister in the house. And that's why David could have said, it wasn't an enemy that reproached me. It was one of my acquaintance, one that I walked the house of God in company, and God said he ate it.
That's right. Glory. Hallelujah.
We have this devilish heart dragging mischief in the body of Christ, and God said he hates it. When they believe. The pastor that said, don't go home with the air that go do this there, this there, and that there. You believe the word of God. Who say that you should not harbor iniquity in your heart.
Amen. Glory.
I rather trust the word of God.
Amen.
That's why I can tell my brethren, wherever you're invited, and you're going to support the house of God, support God's work.
Yes.
Because it's not man's work you're supporting, it is God's work. The Paul said we have to struggle began to be hard come the unity of the faith. We're going to struggle. And when we start thinking our own thinking, we're going to be in trouble. We're going to start keep our minds staying on Christ and the word of God and don't get puffed up with our vain imagination. And sow this thorn and tear apart the kingdom of God. God put a kingdom here to be built.
Yes.
And none of us are important in our local community to do the work that God called us to do.
Amen.
And we work together. High and sharp the high end. So they come to us one breath the other.
Yes.
Wherever they go in the world, they're supposed to walk in any kingdom church.
Amen.
Building and go and praise God.
Hallelujah.
Anywhere.
Amen.
There should not be division in the body of Christ.
Amen.
It's a devilish thing. That the body of Christ is doing. He says he hates it, church.
Hallelujah.
Who are you going to believe?
Glory to God.
A false witness that speaketh lies. It wasn't there, but you want to be a witness. You wasn't a part of the conversation, but you're ready to be a witness for something you know nothing about. God said he hates it. He hates you for doing it. He hates the sin that you're coming in.
Yes.
He not hates you personally, but the sin that you're committing, he hates it, and you gotta stop it.
Glory.
You wanna go in the kingdom of God? You're gonna do what the word of God said you should do, because no sin shall enter the kingdom of God.
Amen.
We can walk as we like, we can talk as we like, but we cannot go into the kingdom as we like. We better enjoy the opportunity we have in this kingdom today. Because we can walk in this kingdom as we like. But the millennium kingdom, you will not make it here. The Bible says when those who are dead in Christ, those who are dead in Christ, church of God, shall arise first. So when you live your life anyhow, and wear the label as Christian, it doesn't mean that you're going to enter the kingdom of God. You're fooling yourself.
Amen.
We're going to do what the Bible says. It is our constitution.
Yes.
It is what we live by.
Yes.
Not by man's theology. By the word of God. Don't add to it. Don't take away from it. The Bible says that if it caused every plague in the book to come into your lives.
Hallelujah.
That's why many of us are suffering. Because everything that God hates is in your life. And then you come and you cry, Pastor, pray for me. Search yourself.
Amen.
You're putting pressure on the pastors and the leaders. Because your heart and your life are right. And you expect to be blessed. And you expect everything to be going the way it should go. When God hates what you're doing. It's time that we start examining ourselves up against the word of God. Let the word of God be your judge.
Hallelujah.
Don't, I cannot be your judge.
Amen.
But the word of God will judge you every time. See, that's why they start this social doctrine. You see? Religious people have this social doctrine. I cannot offend anybody. So they make it a social doctrine. A feel-good doctrine. The Bible says, in the last days, scoffers.
Yes, sir.
Scoffers.
will come. Wolves will come. And the only one thing you're after is not your soul. It's your money. It's your pocketbook. We're going to get to a place where we start walking the way God wants us to walk. Because what he says and what is written is written. Pilate says, what I have written is written. And whatever Jesus has written here and said we should do it, we better do it.
Yes.
We can't get away with it now. When he returns,
hallelujah,
it will not happen. There's no getting away. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And he that soweth discord among brethren. He said this was an abomination. He said the sixth thing is an abomination. That means he hates it more than hates it. Absolutely hates it. It's an abomination to God.
Amen.
But we are sowing discord amongst brethren. Whatever Christian are we? And the Bible says, those that know his will and do it not, what happened? You shall be whipped. You shall be whipped.
Yes,
you shall be whipped.
Yes, sir.
You shall be whipped.
Amen.
With many strife.
Yeah.
Many. So many of us Christians have been getting whipping.
Mm-hmm.
How come, Pastor, God is not going right for me? Really? Are you in line with the word of God so that things should go right with you?
Amen.
We sing the song, you better get right with God. Come and do it now. We have the opportunity right now to lay down at the cross. It's to start afresh. He hates it. Hallelujah. Glory to Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. God is also said to hate human beings. As when he declared, Jacob, I have loved,
yes,
but Esau, I have hated. Romans 9 verse 30. This is a relative hatred. It is not the opposite of love. This hatred is not what we are taught, that the opposite of love is hatred. This is not the type of hate that Jesus Christ is talking about. It is a diminished love. You see, it's a love that is not at the place that he loved Esau. You see what I'm saying? It's a diminished love. God loved Jacob so much that he chose him to become the father of the nation of Israel. But he did not love Esau in the same way. But guess what? He did not love him. But he blessed him, didn't he?
That's right.
Hallelujah.
So because God is blessed, you think everything is right, right? Oh, God blessed me with a house. God blessed me with this car. God blessed me with this. God blessed me with that. And your life is still not where it's supposed to be. You better enjoy the earthly blessing. Because that's all you're going to get. You're losing all your rewards, your crown, and the mansion in glory. Because you won't be able to get in, you'll be outside the gate of dogs and sorcerers and warmongers and all those that live in the light. What a terrible place to be. After all your time, Sundays after Sundays, faithful in giving to build the body of Christ, and you think you're building your mansion, and realize that you're outside the gate and my hut, you don't have. So all you're giving and everything that you're doing is in vain. An awful picture.
So true.
Huh?
Man,
God said he hated Esau, but he loved Jacob. And we knew in scripture that he blessed Esau.
That's right.
Because in Genesis 33 verse 9 it tells you. When Jacob went away and he came back and he brought out the cattle and he wanted to give his brothers, and his brother said, I love Esau.
That's right.
I have enough. He had everything that he wanted. God still blessed him. But he didn't love him. Why? Because he was doing, walking the way God wants him to walk. We are to hate our relatives for the sake of Christ. And that's what the Bible says. We are to hate our relatives. It's a hard thing to think about it. But we got to hate our relatives. What he's saying is that we must love Christ more than your wife.
That's right. That's right.
You must love Christ more than your husband.
That's right.
You must love Christ more than your children.
That's right.
You must love Christ more than your job. You must love him more than your house, your car. You need to love Christ. He must come first. That's what be your first love.
That's right.
So you should try and strive to please God first and foremost. And he said, when you please him, when your ways please him, then your enemy will become your footstool. Your love life will be better. Your marriage will be better. Your children will be better. Your jobs, they will give you more raises. They'll find more favor. Because you love him first. He's first place. Many of us only love God when we need some things, isn't it? But when things good, I gotta take the vacation this week. I don't need to worry, everything is good. You forget when you were crying at the altar and begging God, God, do this to me, help me. If you save my son, I'm going to be dear all the time. If you save my husband, you ask and you make all these promises. And when your husband gets saved, both you in bed wrap up tight. It's cold outside.
It's not really church.
We got to stay home today and cuddle.
Yes.
But when there was misery,
yes,
you run out of the house. You can't wait for Sunday morning.
That's right.
You can't wait for prayer meetings. Because you want to be at the altar.
Yes.
Train out.
Oh, Lord.
Oh, hallelujah.
So true.
Glory to God. Because things are not pretty. But when it's pretty,
yes,
you look out.
Mm.
It's not me not going on here.
It's true.
Yeah.
So true.
Bills are paid every day. I'm not going out here. But Monday morning, you look at it, it's more blizzard, but you're not missing the next guy.
That's right, which is work.
Because you cannot afford the almighty dollar to leave. They want to provide you a million dollar. We're the Bird Box State Church.
Very nice. Very nice.
Bird Box State.
Yes. So true.
We got to love Christ first.
Amen.
Seek ye first.
Kingdom
of God.
Yes.
And all its righteousness.
Glory.
And all
Amen.
Time the body of Christ get back to your first love. Start loving Christ like the first day you met him and you were in love with him. You didn't need to think about the wife then. You think about the husband then. Because you were in love. You found a new love. You were just dancing. You were just singing to him in the morning. You get up and you read his word. You get on your knees and pray. And cry out and thank him. But now you get comfortable. Get out comfortable. Some of us, we used to have to run outside and sit, start the car and sit there waiting for the warm up shaking. Some of us at the bus stop waiting in the bitter cold.
Yes.
And you beg God for that car.
Remember them days. Amen.
And then God bless you and you forget.
Yeah.
Your first love.
Amen.
Oh, hallelujah. Amen. If any man come to me and hate not his father and mother, wife, children, brethren, sisters, yea, and his whole life,
amen,
also, he cannot be my disciple.
That's right.
Isn't that something? Even your whole life,
mm-hmm,
you're going to prepare to give it up.
That's right.
For him.
Amen.
Amen.
Oh, God. Your own life. You're ready,
mm-hmm,
and willing to say, if I got to go,
mm-hmm,
I got to go.
Mm-hmm.
But you see, God give us everything that we need to give us comfort, even in this time. Because Paul caught revelation.
Right.
And Paul said, to be absent from the body,
right,
to be present with the Lord.
Yes.
So you can kill this body, but you cannot kill
the
soul. Somebody, I'm ready.
Yes.
And I'm ready,
yes,
to die,
yes,
for the things of God.
Yes. I know where I'm going.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Well, you ready? You don't know where you're going.
That's right.
You sell out.
That's right.
You can't preach the word of God in truth anymore.
Yeah.
Because your bills have to be paid.
Mm-hmm.
You're depending on the brethren so much that you start compromising sin.
That's right.
Because your bill has to be paid. You forget who's the one who paid the bill. That's religion.
Mm-hmm.
There's just people not looking to the source.
Yeah.
Because I have the knowledge that I have a king who is responsible for me. I love my brethren, and I'd like them to take care of me some days because I might need it to never end.
Mm-hmm.
And I won't say don't, but I'm not looking to my brethren. I'm looking to the king, the source, because in the kingdom, he promised, if we keep his commandments, he's there to bless and to do us good.
Amen.
Let's not get religious.
Amen.
Let's get the things that God hates out of our lives.
Amen.
Can we do that?
Amen.
Can we do that?
Amen.
It means that you should love these people. Bless. It's not mean you should hate them with an absolute hatred. It means, just mean that you need to let Christ be here in you, to be the first place in your lives. We need to make Christ be
first
in our lives. Matthew 10 verse 37 says, he that loveth father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. And he that loveth sons and daughters more than he is not worthy of me. Isn't that something?
That's right.
And it does not mean absolute hatred first. I want to test again. It means you must put Jesus first. Believers, this is the part for us. That's very hard. We got to love our enemy.
Mm-hmm.
Believers, you must love your enemy.
Mm-hmm.
Your enemies, you must love them. Even they hate you and despitefully use you and say all manner of evil against you, you gotta still love them. Isn't that something? We must love our enemies. That's what it says in Matthew 5, verse 43 to 44. You have heard that it has said, have been said, thou shalt love thy neighbor and hate thy enemy. But how? Say that Jesus Christ is. Who are we following?
Jesus Christ.
Who are we following?
Jesus Christ.
And this is what he said. said. It has been said that this here he says that going on in his time, and it's what the church will understand. And this way, it has been said, thou shalt love thy neighbor and hate thy enemy. But I say, come on, church, say that to me. But I say, but I say,
I say,
but I say,
I say
unto you, love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you, and pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you. That's what kingdom people will do. You cannot have hate in your hearts. Get rid of it.
Yes.
It's not godly. I forgive them, but I can't forget it. What is that? You're still harboring things in your heart. How you love them? I hate them. There's no medium here. So you want to make sure that if your enemy, you know they hate you, but you still need to love them. How are they? But who do you believe? Whose report are you going to believe? The emotional roller coaster that's within you? Or is the Spirit of God that will direct you? So I many of the churches are in trouble. They don't need the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
They don't want the Holy Ghost. And the Holy Ghost is there to teach you, to strengthen you, and strengthen your will.
Yes.
The will to do. The will of God is strengthened by the Holy Ghost. This flesh itself cannot do it. The will to love your enemy can only happen through the grace and the power of Jesus Christ in you.
That's right.
So you see all those people that you hate? Go and talk to them and say, listen, I'm sorry. I just learned I can't hate you no more. So all those ex, those husbands that you have left and you think that you are carrying some hatred, you better get rid of it. Some neighbors that hurt you, you think I hate them, I won't even go, I won't even say hi to them, you better get rid of it. I thank God I had this knowledge a long time ago. God told me, he said, I want you to call and talk to everyone that you hurt. Make it right. And I did. So I can preach in freedom. I don't need to know why I had to do all these things. Now I'm understanding it. Amen. I had to get rid of all those yoke and those baggage and all the weight and all the sin that easily beset me. I had to get rid of it.
Amen.
So that God and I can speak without compromise.
Amen.
Because I have done it. So you have some baggage, but hatred carried for some people, get rid of it.
That's right.
If not, you will not enter the kingdom of God.
Amen.
I want to read this again and then we're going to close here. Matthew 5, can we read that together? Matthew 5, verse 43 to 44. Let's read it aloud then. But let's shame the devil, because we're going to walk out of here today and we're going to make some things right.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
You have heard that in time past, that thou shalt love thy neighbor and hate thy enemy. But I, Jesus Christ, say unto you, love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you, and pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you.
Amen.
Let's read Ephesians chapter 5, verse 3. Okay, that's a long one. You'll read it on your by yourself, church.
that 14 verses. But you're going to take that in your note, Ephesians chapter 5 from verse 3 to 14. Hallelujah. You can read that by yourself. Hallelujah. Wicked people living under the power of Satan will hate the Lord Jesus Christ and his followers. Church of God, don't expect to be loved by the world.
That's right.
Don't expect to be loved by the world. Jesus Christ, let us know that.
That's right.
The world hated him before he hates you.
That's right.
But we cannot return the favor. We got to love them anyhow. You know what happens when you love your enemy? The Bible says that evil calls a fire on your head. Do you know what it means when it says call a fire on your head? It means it will convict them.
That's right.
It'll expect you to love them. Knowing that, they hate you. Say, anywhere people hate me, I like to go there. Anybody hates me, I like to go there. Because they don't expect me to be there. You see?
So true.
Surprise!
Yes. Yes. You love your man, love the way he said, man.
But I cannot harbor hatred in my heart because I know who Jesus is.
Yes.
And I know the word of God. And the Bible said it's a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my pathway. And I know I can live in this world as I like, but I can't go into the millennium kingdom as I like. There's some things I need to drop out, and I'm going to do it.
Amen.
Oh, glory to God. This is what he said about the world. In John 8, verse 44. Ye are your father's, the devil. And the lust of your father, you will do. He was a murderer from the beginning, and abhorred not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaketh a lie, he speaketh of his own, for he is a liar and a murderer.
Yeah.
He's the father
of lies.
He's the father
of lies,
church. So the Christian youth is not to strike back, but to go and do good to his enemy. Church, go and do good to your enemy. I got a question and closing here. Will you accept or have that a cultural Christianity or a cross-centered Christianity? I want to say it again because this is very important. Will you accept or adopt a cultural Christianity? It's our question. Because you still have to choose. Because Christianity become a cultural thing. And it's also a nickname for the saints. So, cultural Christianity is not for us. What we need is a cross-centered Christianity. A cross-centered Christianity. What did Jesus say? He says, take up your cross what? What? Daily. Every morning, it could be a new cross. Pick it up. And follow him. Let's not fall into the cultural Christianity that don't want to talk about sin. That all they want is your money. They don't care where you go to hell. They don't care. They say, well, I can't say that because you can't go to hell. But you'll be outside the gate. Christian cannot go to hell because they'd have to take Jesus Christ and the Holy Ghost with him. But you can't see outside the gate. Revelation 22, verse 15. Those outside the gate. Dogs, sorcerers, warmongers, murderers, all those who live it and tell it a lie. Think those are unsaved?
Christian
that sow discord among brethren. Christians that sow discord and hatred among brethren.
It is better to experience Jesus' unconditional and eternal love than to win a popularity contest and to be liked by the world. Don't want to be popular. I don't want to win no popularity contest. I want to know him for speaking the word of God.
Amen.
To its fullest. Not diluted, but undiluted word of God. Because at the end of the day, I want all of you to go and stand before Christ. And he can say, well done, the good and faithful servant.
Amen.
That's what I want. That's what I want.
Yes.
God's grace be with you. God is faithful, shining, shining. We give you peace.